Okay, if I could invite members of the public who are leaving the public gallery and those leaving the chamber to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible as we move on to the next item of business, which is a members' business debate on motion 10788 in the name of Daniel Johnson on increases in youth antisocial behaviour. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. As ever, I invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Daniel Johnson to open the debate around 7 minutes. Mr Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I also thank members from across the chamber for signing my motion? Because this is a difficult issue. I think it's been very clear for a number of months now from speakers and members from across the chamber that there is an issue regarding youth antisocial behaviour that is increasing. And there may be a broad range of different reasons. There may be complex issues at play. There is certainly the case that post-COVID, many of our young people have been struggling to adjust and struggling to deal with the issues that are consequent for that. But I think we also need to be frank and clear when these issues are occurring. And I think we also need to be very clear that our constituents may well understand that these are complex social issues, but I think they also want that candour and clarity about what is happening and some frankness about some of the steps that can be taken in order to address it. Now, in terms of this, I come to this with a background having brought forward a member's bill successfully to deal with the issue of violence and abuse against shop workers. And I think what was clear to me as I did that was that it was an issue that was growing in seriousness and that we had to take steps. And I'm very pleased that since the introduction of that legislation and it coming into force, that there have been 3,500 charges brought using that act. But it has also been clear to me, speaking to both shop workers, unions and retailers, that we are seeing an increased incidence of those violent attacks and incidents of abuse. But there's also a growing pattern within that of youth antisocial behaviour, with youths abusing shop workers, causing violent incidents and disruptive incidents in stores. And I think that's part of a wider pattern. Because I've also noted in my own casework an increasing array of different incidents and patterns of behaviour which are of deep concern to me. And these range from seemingly innocuous incidents such as eggs being thrown. But when you cross the threshold and there are incidents of young mothers pushing prams being attacked by youths with eggs, I think it stops being trivial and starts being serious. There's also incidents of vandalism, persistent vandalism of groups of youths that have led into arson. In recent weeks and months, there have been situations where balaclavaed youths have amassed in ranks and taunted police officers, seemingly with impunity. And then, most recently, we have seen the incidents that the member for Edinburgh Eastern alludes to, and she's quite right. I don't think we should be holding up any particular communities, because I am very clear. These are issues that affect all communities across Edinburgh. And frankly, my observation is this is just as much a problem in Morningside as it is in Nidtree. I don't think necessarily family background is the indicator here. And I think that hints at some of the issues that are at the heart of this. Because I think we are seeing a pattern of behaviour of groups of youths, not necessarily numerous, but they are persistent. I think we also need to recognise that while free bus passes for young people have been a huge opportunity and benefit, they are being abused by a minority. And we're seeing some of these young people moving quite large distances and causing a broad range of problems in different places. I'm happy to give way to the member.
Brian Whittle.
I'm very grateful for Dan Johnson for giving way. Would he agree with me that we need to look at how that privilege that is given to the youth can be taken away when behaviour dictates?
Daniel Johnson.
I think the member raises a very important point, and I will just come to it in a brief moment. I just want to round off one of the points that I'm making. So first, and then the third strand, I think, to the phenomenon we're seeing is the use of social media. There's definitely a situation here where young people are seeing behaviours and copying them, and social media is playing a part. And talking to the police, I get a sense of deep frustration. And I think that frustration is twofold. I think, firstly, They are equally frustrated as both community members and retail workers are in terms of their ability to actually attend these incidents when they occur. And I think they also ask the question whether or not they have the powers to intervene that they are that they may need. So, indeed.
Liam Kerr.
I'm just very grateful. I'm enjoying Daniel Johnson's contribution. I just take him back to the point earlier. He said something about the charges under his own legislation being at something like 3,500. Does he have any idea of what happens after the charge and what the outcomes are? Because that seems to me crucial both to that and the point he's making now.
Daniel Johnson.
Look, I think it's fair to say there's an emerging picture there. I mean, what is often happening is we are just stuck. First of all, there is the issue around the backlog of cases at the courts, and that has undoubtedly impeded things. Secondly, and understandably, sometimes prosecutors don't pursue the charges under my Act because they wish to pursue more serious charges, and in particular ones that might actually carry a higher tariff. So I wouldn't like to say specifically, but not every instance of charges under my legislation is resulting in conviction, but there are a number of reasons, I think some understandable, some that are of greater concern. But look, in terms of response, let me set out, I think, three broad principles. First of all, I think we absolutely all agree that we must have prevention and we must have progressive responses, such as diversion practice, but those require investment and resource. Secondly, I am very clear, and to Brian Whittle's point, I absolutely believe that people have rights, but with those rights come responsibilities. And when those rights are abused, I think we need to question what happens. And I think, thirdly to all of this, I think that we need to ask ourselves that absolutely we must focus on measures that are preventative, focus on measures that that seek to divert, but we also need to ask ourselves, what happens when those interventions, when those diversions don't work? What actions and steps can we take? So in closing, I'd just like to ask the following questions. I think we do need to ask ourselves about what the impact has been in terms of the closure of youth services and youth initiatives, because everyone is clear that those play a very clear role, and we have also seen a decline in the funding for those things, and that has an impact. Secondly, I'd like to ask the question is whether we have the interventions available. Should we be asking ourselves that question? If young people are using bus passes to do some of these things, should those bus passes be suspended for a period of time if they are abused? And I think we also just need to... We understand about there being non-criminal or criminal justice interventions in the home and... Well, I don't have much time, but...
Ruth Maguire, briefly.
I appreciate him taking intervention. I just wonder if you'd reflect on whether removing a child's ability to travel around might prevent them from attending work, which can be diversionary from antisocial behaviour, or the youth clubs and things that they were talking about.
Daniel Johnson, if you could start concluding.
I'm not being categorical. I'm simply asking the question. What I don't think you can do is continue to allow someone to use it without questioning if it's being used for nefarious purposes. I think we're very clear about interventions that can be made in schools, in our homes, that are not in the category of criminal justice, but simply where young people make a mess or cause a disturbance, we ask them to clear them up. I just wonder whether or not we can look and think about non-criminal justice interventions, but absolutely ensuring that there are consequences to certain actions. And then just finally, I think there has been a real focus, and understandably, about creating centralised and specialised police functions within Police Scotland. But I get the sense, talking to police officers, the question is, have we got the balance right? Has that taken resource away from response officers, from community policing, and have we got that balance right? And I'll close there, Deputy Presiding Officer. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Johnson. We now move to the open debate. I call for Stuart McMillan to be followed by Craig Hoy, around 4 minutes. Mr McMillan.
Thank you very much, Mr Presiding Officer. First, I want to thank Daniel Johnson for securing this debate. And his motion refers to the impact of antisocial behaviour and youth disorder in businesses in his Edinburgh Southern constituency. Now, I sympathise with this. I'm not going to talk about Edinburgh Southern. I'm going to talk about my area and things that have actually happened in my location, because I know it certainly is it's an issue that every single MSP in the Chamber will have had to attend to and deal with. In my constituency, I previously carried out a survey of local businesses around the Greenock West train station regarding antisocial behaviour following discussions with some of the retailers. And the results indicated that people were just loitering around the shop can put people off entering. And I shared the information I got back with local stakeholders to help them better understand the concerns of the local shopkeepers and hopefully find ways to address them. There have also been issues regarding the boy racers in the Tesco's in Greenock car park after the shop closes, with the noise and the headlights flashing into the adjacent homes, disturbing the residents at all hours. But youth disorder and antisocial behaviour can take many, many forms. And for example, Inverclyde is currently served by 13 train stations, so youths tend to congregate at locations they can access via the train, which is different from other parts of the country, whereas it's buses, my area, it's mostly trains. Now, this could be partly near Woodhall Station, McDonald's in Port Glasgow, near the Port Glasgow Station and Inverkip Harbourside, which is a short walk from the Inverkip Station. Now, the rail network in Inverclyde plays such a key role in the movement of youths, and most of whom are just wanting to spend some time with their pals, but often that very small cohort are the ones who want to cause trouble. Presiding officer, I was keen to speak in today's debate to highlight some of the good partnership working in Inverclyde to actually deal with some of the youth disorder. Because although I do sympathise with Mr Johnson's concerns, this motion doesn't offer up any local solutions to actually try to attend to some of the issues. We as MSPs also have a role to play to try to help. Now, I'm not saying that we have got a magic cure in Inverclyde. I'm certainly not saying that we have eradicated youth disorder. However, we have made some significant strides in dealing with the issues at the Inverkip Harbourside, certainly this year, which I attribute to the joint working by local stakeholders. So two actions have actually taken place. First of all, for over 5 years, I've convened a group consisting of the local community council, ward councillors, Police Scotland, BTP, community wardens, ScotRail, and also some local residents to help to bring a focus to the issue. This has also led to, at various times, targeted work at some of the local train stations to actually prevent people from heading down to the Harbourside area. No party politics has been played in this issue because it's been about the safety of the community and also the safety of the younger people themselves. This localised approach certainly has been helpful. The second action has been via the partnership hub headed up by Police Scotland in Inverclyde. This involves partners from the police, Inverclyde Council, local RSLs, the Fire and Rescue and Health and Social Care and others when required, aiming to deal with antisocial behaviour in Inverclyde, including youth disorder. The Minister for Community Safety and Victims recently visited the partnership hub at my after I invited her to come along to it, and I know that she genuinely was impressed by the approach that's been taken within Inverclyde. Now, saying also, youth disorder in Inverkip in my constituency has been a problem for many, many years, often dissipating and then spiking again, and typically coinciding certainly with the good weather. But I think it's important to mention that during a debate on this subject, that we actually all were young once. No doubt all of us at some point in our past have probably made some mistakes. We also probably attended gatherings when there was a vast majority of the individuals were well behaved, but that small minority didn't. Now, this can lead to others not looking for trouble, sadly actually being dragged in. And in these instances, Inverclyde Council, they send out parent alert letters to try to address this. The parents are told that the child was at a certain location on a certain night when youth disorder took place. The young person might have had nothing at all to do with any of that disorder, but they could have been dragged into it inadvertently. So the letters are to actually make parents aware and encourage them to check up on where the kids actually are. Now, returning to the partnership hub, I'm conscious of time, presiding officer, and I'm about to finish. Returning to the partnership hub, the focus given to Inverkip before and during the summer led to what I know has actually been a vast reduction in youth disorder. Now, I want to thank everyone involved and pass on the thanks from my constituents who certainly have been in contact with me. And I know this approach will continue and other areas affected by youth disorder can be addressed in a similar successful way. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McMillan. I now call Craig Hoy to be followed by Stephen Kerr in 4 minutes. Mr Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I would like to start by thanking Daniel Johnson for bringing forward this important debate and to concur with many of the points that Mr Johnson made. At the outset, it is important to note that the vast majority of young people in Scotland are thoughtful, caring and kind, even if, like all of us at that age, a little boisterous at times. And they should not be tarred with the same brush as the very, very small minority of young people who commit antisocial behaviour offences, sometimes, though, they are extreme in nature. But the good behaviour of the many should not act as a smokescreen to avoid talking about the extreme behaviour of the small minority who make people's lives a misery on a daily basis. We cannot turn a blind eye to the mindless thuggery and antisocial behaviour by these groups. Groups who run rampant, safe in the knowledge that even if they are arrested, they are very likely unlikely to be prosecuted, and they are even less likely to go to jail. This summer, significant youth-related antisocial behaviour incidents were reported to me across the south of Scotland, in Haddington, in Preston Pans, in Long Nidry, in East Linton, and in Peebles in the Scottish Borders. Cars damaged, pensioners targeted, houses egged, property vandalised, young people attacked, weapons used. At Lynn Rocks in East Linton, a large group of young people from as far afield as Edinburgh, who were abusing their access to free bus travel, gathered to drink alcohol and consume drugs, harassing and verbally and physically threatening passers-by. But the community did not take this lying down, Deputy Presiding Officer. Working with the Council's Antisocial Behaviour Team and Police Scotland, I convened a number of meetings to drive a cross-agency, cross-community approach. And realising the extent of community concerns, Police Scotland took a zero-tolerance approach, and I thank Chief Inspector Ben Leith for this intervention. These actions also showed the benefits of a well-organised local authority response, including the location of a temporary CCTV camera by East Lothian Council in East Linton. Young people were handcuffed and removed from the area. The community breathed a sigh of relief, but sadly, as is the case in so many other incidents, the problem was displaced, not solved. Our police are overstretched and woefully under-resourced. They are unable to respond like this to every single case of antisocial behaviour in our communities. And in Haddington, there have been reports of underaged hooded youths causing damage to shops, abusing and threatening staff because they refused to sell them alcohol. Windows were smashed, and two staff members resigned after receiving death threats. Data has revealed that the number of bobbies on the beat in East Lothian dropped to its lowest level since 2008, between April and June of this year. And at the same time, 1,352 ASB incidents were reported. And incidents of antisocial behaviour have also been felt across the Scottish borders. In Peebles, sadly, a man in his 80s had his car windscreen smashed, and he was then beaten up. Schoolgirls were kicked in the face, videoed by perpetrators, a process and a practice that is now sadly all too common in these incidents. In Peebles, a total of 56 antisocial behaviour calls were made in the second quarter of this year. And it is unacceptable that people in Borders towns have felt unsafe in their own communities as a result of this. But this is not the fault of our communities or the police. The buck stops with the SNP. They have left our police service under-resourced since coming to power 16 years ago. I can do.
Ben McPherson.
I think Craig Hoy has made some really important points in his contribution so far, but does he not agree with me that these issues are so complex and challenging and affecting so many communities that we all need to take responsibility for the solutions we need to find together?
Craig Hoy.
In East Linton, where the community came together with the police and the council and the problem was resolved. But sadly, when I speak to the police, they say that due to 15 years of SNP neglect, they are simply unable to go into the communities in the way that they once were. And I think the other issue is that many, as a result of the lack of policing, many of those youths now believe they are untouchable. They can repeat the same crimes in the same places time and time again. And councils across the south of Scotland are equally under-resourced. Despite their best efforts, their antisocial behaviour teams and community wardens are severely overstretched. As antisocial behaviour incidents intensify, we owe our police, our councils, our communities more than just warm words. We owe them the financial support and the legal framework, and also a justice system which allows them to do their job. But sadly, on this and on so many other problems facing Scotland today, the SNP's priorities lie elsewhere.
Thank you. I now call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Paul O'Kane, and in 4 minutes, Mr. Kerr.
I'm grateful to Daniel Johnson for bringing this motion to Parliament, and I also want to congratulate him on his speech. It was very measured, and I have to say that I'll not be unique in this chamber. My inbox is full of my constituents with their concerns about this issue. They are less measured than that Daniel Johnson is in what he has to say. I've been working with a number of people on this issue for nearly 2.5 years, the whole 2.5 years I've been here. And one couple in particular, I visited their home just on Monday, And this is an email I got this morning. This is the 89th incident that's occurred in the property next door to them, which is occupied by a social, by a young person. This, last night, 25 to 12, the police turn up on that doorstep, thumping the door, banging the windows to try and gain access, because they've been called by the occupant of that house on the basis of a threat to life. This, by the way, is the, I don't know what number I said earlier, but this is actually the 84th occasion this has happened. It also involves the ambulance service. It's not untypical. This goes on until 20 to 1, banging, noise, trying to gain entry, still can't get in. 5 past 1, more police arrive, more banging. 1:45, before the cars go away, because they've had to bang through, they have to take force to go through the door. Council workmen arrive, bless their cotton socks, at 2:07 in the morning. This is just not acceptable. This kind of behaviour is intolerable, and yet we have not got things in place to deal with it. Lives are being made miserable. This couple in Bonnybridge, their lives have been made hell. The lady has health issues. The husband is driven to the very edge by this behaviour. And we seem to have a police force that's unwilling or unable to act. We often seem to have prosecutors that seem that come across as not being very interested in the rights of victims. That's been my own experience. And we have a judicial system that seems unable to protect communities from violence and fear. Now, we don't do any favours to our young people or the future by not establishing boundaries, what is right and what is wrong. Those boundaries are very clear when it comes to behaviour. Some young people are growing up believing they can get away with just about anything, and they're more than happy to tell you their rights, whether you're a police officer or whether you're a teacher. Ask teachers, ask police officers, because they have no fear of detection, no fear of sanction. And the police do lack the resources to deal with this. The prosecutors probably don't have the resources either. The judicial system is about to breaking point. But we must establish boundaries. Boundaries where young people know what's expected of them and how to live in a civilised society. And we have a tradition of civilised living together in our society. And stepping outside these boundaries must come with consequences. Now, Daniel Johnson called for frank discussion about these issues. These are the things that the people of Scotland are saying. They want to see boundaries and consequences. There must be discouragement to those who are offending and repeat offending. Now, those boundaries clearly begin at home. Parents are the first line in giving young people a sense of a moral compass and what is right and what is wrong. But too often, the apparatus of government in Scotland, in one form or another, makes parents second-guess themselves as to whether they're doing the right thing by teaching their children boundaries and right and wrong. We must reverse this trend that so many people feel is happening in our society and give help and support to families, not hinder and undermine them. And my colleague, Ros McCall, at First Minister's Questions, highlighted this week's news from Fife Council, where those responsible for the eradication of bullying in the public school system actually said, you shouldn't do anything to upset the bullies. Where are we going? Now, my time is up, and I appreciate that. And so I'll just conclude by saying, if we think what we've been doing is going to remedy this situation, we need to think again. We need change, we need boundaries, we need a sense of right and wrong. There need to be consequences and sanctions.
Thank you. I now call Paul O'Kane to be followed by Sue Webber in 4 minutes, Mr O'Kane.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And the scenes in Edinburgh and across other parts of Scotland, as described across the Chamber today, are hugely concerning. And perhaps most acutely in this last month, when we've had Halloween and Bonfire Night that do appear to be pinch points for these instances of antisocial behaviour. Indeed, attacks on police and the misuse of fireworks have seen residents scared to leave their homes, and there are unacceptable scenes on our streets, and there must rightly be investigations and assessments of what has happened and why it has happened. But I don't think we should see the pinch points within the year as being one-off or isolated. Indeed, I think, as we've already heard from colleagues, problems with antisocial behaviour seem to persist at all parts of the year, and indeed in all parts of the country. I am grateful to my friend Daniel Johnson for bringing this debate today, because I think it does give us an opportunity to express the concerns of our own communities and start to try and explore, certainly in a constructive way, some of the solutions that we might be able to put forward. West Scotland is affected by antisocial behaviour and indeed violence in many communities, and I have heard firsthand from constituents about the blight it plays upon their lives. In May of this year, there was a spike of antisocial behaviour in Barrhead, where residents felt completely cut off and isolated in many ways, due to the antisocial behaviour that was taking place in parts of the town. Indeed, residents have repeatedly complained about being assaulted in the town centre at night, particularly outside the local Asda store and the local Foundry Leisure Centre and Library. And indeed, a group of young people have repeatedly targeted security staff and customers at Asda in Barrhead and at the Foundry as well. Last month, in the neighbouring village of Neilston, there was a reported increase in the number of incidents as well, with eggs and stones being thrown at properties. And whilst that might seem at fairly low level, I spoke to, for example, a new mother this morning, a young mother who found that quite intimidating when her car was attacked with eggs. And then just before Halloween, McGill's, the local bus company, were forced to suspend services at 5 p.m. On two routes through the Auchinbach estate in Barrhead due to violent incidents against its drivers and buses. So I think we can see the real impact that this sort of antisocial behaviour is having in terms of that cutting off of communities that I referred to. I have written to the area commander for police and engaged with the council, indeed, to try and work out what the solutions could be. I've also written to the minister, and I hope that she will be able to engage with that correspondence in terms of what more support can be given by government to help agencies who are working in the community, because I do absolutely recognise what Daniel Johnson has said about the mix of approaches that we need to take in terms of dealing with this. Of course, there's an issue in terms of police resourcing. Indeed, Police Scotland will say that they want to take a multi-agency approach, that they want to ensure that they are trauma-informed. But that is often very, very challenging when the other services that have to be put in to that approach are really struggling in terms of resourcing and in terms of having the staff available. So, you know, there have been huge cuts to local authorities, and it's not just about the diversionary activities like youth services, but actually, more fundamentally, social work services for many of the young people who come from traumatic and chaotic lives and families where they're not getting the right support because social work are having to always respond to crisis and aren't able to perhaps do some of the more in-depth work that can help to divert young people away and also approach them where they are, if you like. I did notice that the government's response has been to issue the Reviewing Scotland's Approach to Antisocial Behaviour document. I noticed that within that there were two recommendations. One, that recognised that a long-term approach is needed, and I think everyone in the chamber would acknowledge that. But the other is that there's going to be the convening of that expert group. Now, I welcome that, and I think we should all engage in it, but my concern would be we can't just say it's a long-term approach, leave it to another working group and not see any tangible action. So, conscious of my time, Deputy Presiding Officer, I shall leave it with that thought, and I'm keen that the Minister does lay out in her closing, if she can, where that group will go and what tangible action it will take, and I'm very grateful.
Thank you, Mr O'Kane. And I call Sue Webber to be followed by Brian Whittler in 4 minutes. Ms Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I certainly feel it's timely to have the chance to speak in this debate today, given the shocking behaviour that took place across our capital city over the weekend. Riot police in Edinburgh spent Sunday night battling fireworks and petrol bombs during bonfire night. Police Scotland said that their officers experienced an unprecedented level of violence as they tried to tackle the disorder. Police were called to the Nidgett area of Edinburgh on Sunday evening following reports of antisocial use of fireworks against residents. And the riot police, part of Operation Moonbeam, were then sent in to assist the local officers. and it's believed around 50 people were involved with clashes with the police, who came under attack from fireworks, petrol bombs and other projectiles. The level of disturbance in Nidri was unacceptable and frankly disgusting. And only 4 weeks ago, in my column in the local paper, I wrote about the impact of the SNP's police budget cuts and how repeated cost-cutting had slashed the number of frontline officers and that this was contributing to a rise in antisocial behaviour. The events of Bonfire Night demonstrated once again that there's a hardcore element determined not just to challenge authority, but who positively revel in making ordinary people feel uncomfortable in their own homes and communities. The riot in Nidri was only the most visible and shocking flashpoint, but outbreaks of antisocial behaviour across the city meant police and fire services resources were stretched to their limits, and they came under attack across the wider region. With our police stretched to breaking point, the criminals knew that they could get away with it, frankly. One of my constituents, Ian, who is a retired police officer, wrote to me earlier this week expressing his concern following the weekend. He said, "As I predicted, the new legislation is utterly toothless, pushing down decision-making and blame to local authorities to create exclusion zones is now proven not to work, especially when there is a greatly reduced police service. The 5th of November is now seen as an opportunity to indulge in anarchy, and the problem, in my opinion, will only get worse if left unchallenged or unchanged." Yes, I will.
Minister.
Thank the member for taking an intervention. And I appreciate everything that happened last weekend was abhorrent on every single level. But will you recognise, with the legislation that's come in against emergency workers, that last year 61 people were charged and only 2 people have been charged so far? But investigations are still ongoing and more are expected to be charged.
Sue Webber.
Firstly, I'd like to inquire, if you can in your closing remarks, as to what the outcomes of those charges were against those individuals that attacked our emergency workers, because that's the problem. And these are petrol bombs that are being thrown. I'm sorry, they are not covered in the fireworks legislation at all. The same policeman told me how much time he'd spent dealing with antisocial behaviour use, and a ban on fireworks is a prerequisite. November the 5th is, as Ian said, an excuse to create mayhem. But given the police the resources to deal with it, will have the benefits for us all year round. And we can all agree that, sadly, antisocial behaviour is not just limited to this one time of year. On Friday, I met a father called Nico, who lives in Curry. He was at the end of his tether. His family have been targeted for over a year by a group of 4 youths who regularly dressed in black hoods, throwing eggs, tins of beans and traffic cars at his possessions, his car and his home. And I have seen the shocking videos of this happening. Nico and his family feel that they can't relax at home, and now the nights are darker, they won't use the living room at the front of their house or leave the light on, as this encourages these people more. The night before Nico came to see me, his local neighbourhood watch met to discuss the incidents and if there was anything they could do. And the father of one of the boys tormenting his family came along as well. And they all feel, the school, the police, the parents, all of their hands are tied. The police are already involved and have been to one of the boys' house many times. The father of that boy is at his wit's end and doesn't feel as if there's anything he can do about disciplining his son. I'm meeting the police on Friday in the southwest of Edinburgh, and I will be raising this and many of the incidents I have. Earlier this week, this Community Safety Minister, Siobhan Brown, announced a new independent working group to tackle antisocial behaviour. We are already hearing of potential recommendations linked to the confiscation or the curfews for the under-22 bus passes, perhaps. But one thing is clear. There is only one group of people who like a working group more than the SNP, and that is the criminals.
Thank you. I now call Brian Whittle to be followed by Ben McPherson in 4 minutes. Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I congratulate Daniel Johnson for bringing this debate to the Chamber and for his thoughtful introduction to the debate. In September 2022, Stagecoach said it would no longer run evening services from Kilmarnock bus station due to antisocial behaviour perpetrated by our youth. They were using the free bus pass, gangs were using the free bus pass to travel to other areas to cause that those behaviours. In April 2023, a teenager who attempted to stab a 14-year-old boy to death with a broken bottle at Kamarnock bus station, jailed for more than 4 years. And in October 2023, a Kamarnock bus station security worker has been left with a broken nose after being assaulted by two teenagers who have subsequently been arrested and charged in connection with the incident and will appear in court. Now, Daniel Johnson mentioned COVID, and I think COVID has had an impact on our youth. I think the social skills, the lack of social skills there could be a driver to some of this violence. The access to youth clubs, to scouts, to guides, to sport, to music and art that I've discussed many a time in here was taken away. And I think that what these, as I've said many times as well, what these activities do for our youth is an encouragement into better behaviour. It's about self-worth. It's about confidence. It's about resilience. It's about aspiration. It's about, of course, I'll give way here.
Stephen Kerr. And I agree with what Brian Whittle's saying, but there's also a need for there to be a clear understanding of where the line is between good behaviour and bad behaviour, and that there are consequences that flow from bad behaviour. It may not be the kind of discussion that some members in this Parliament want to hear, but this is what the people of Scotland think, and this is what the people of Scotland want to see happen.
Brian Whittle.
And I wouldn't deny that. I do believe there should be consequences to bad behaviour, but there's another side to this coin, is we have to create an environment where we can instil better behaviour. And I think the types of activities that I've been speaking about there are where we can these youth can understand the benefits of working together, of working with others, where they have the benefit of learning about hard work. And understanding where those, a level of understanding where those boundaries actually stand. And I think that, as has been mentioned, I think over a longer period of time, the eroding of council funding or the erosion of funding for our third sector, who are so crucial in this particular issue, or even the funding in our education system, where a lot of these interventions that I've discussed actually begin. And I think this erosion of that funding is such a false economy, as we can see from recent antisocial behaviour, where we spend in one page of a ledger, we don't spend in one page of a ledger, which means we need to spend in another page of a ledger, as we saw when those horrific scenes in Edinburgh. Now, I would finish by just saying that, you know, I've spoke before about my own experience over my lifetime, and a more diverse group of friends from such a wide variety of backgrounds you could not meet. But we were introduced to each other and our lives have actually been shaped through our intervention with sport. Shared togetherness through our passion in sport. We need to ensure that opportunity, is that whatever that may be for our youth, is available and accessible for all, because it's not just about that. There is about one side of the coin about making sure there are repercussions for behaviour, but there's another side of the coin that says we have to have the opportunity to ensure that our youth can participate. At that, Deputy Speaker, I will sit down. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Whittle. I'm conscious of the number of members who still want to participate in the debate. To allow that to happen, I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes and invite Daniel Johnson to move such a motion.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? That is agreed. I therefore call Ben McPherson to be followed by Alexander Stewart. Around 4 minutes, Mr. McPherson.
I also want to start by thanking Daniel Johnson for bringing this really important issue to the Chamber and allowing us to consider the challenge of bad behaviour generally in our society. This is not just an issue in Edinburgh Southern. It's not just an issue in Edinburgh, as others have alluded to. It's not even just an issue in Scotland. Other parts of the UK are facing real challenges. There's a truth we need to acknowledge that members have also emphasised, which is that most people who are young are behaving really, really well and doing really, really good things. Our young people have also grown up in a challenging time. The financial crash and its consequences, austerity, the pandemic, the cost of living crisis and war in the world. But what's also true amongst those facts is that, and we can't underplay this, there are rightly concerns about a minority of some young people who are engaging in really challenging antisocial behaviour. And I fear, colleagues and presiding officer, that it's getting worse. It's in our schools, as has been discussed, and the government has its work ongoing on these very challenging issues. It's happening in our streets, and it's happening in shops. Others have talked about the challenges when it comes to big supermarkets, but it's also an issue for SMEs in our communities. For example, Argonaut Bookshop in Leith, just in recent weeks, had hundreds of pounds worth of damage from a small minority of young people coming in and throwing eggs around the shop. It's a huge issue, and as Daniel Johnson rightly argued, a complex one. There's a broad range of reasons for this phenomenon. It's a trend. It's influenced by social media. And also, it has been shown on occasion, also influenced by organised crime. The solution... Yeah?
Brian Whittle.
Very grateful for Ben McPherson for giving way, and I can't disagree with anything that he said so far, but I wonder if you agree with me that over that period of time there's also been an erosion of that sort of community spirit, coupled with a rise in poor mental health, and all of that there in a complex web is contributing to this kind of behaviour.
Ben McPherson.
That's absolutely true, and it goes back to the context that I mentioned around the financial challenge and the pressure on our society. And our young people have grown up in that, in households that are experiencing that pressure, in communities that are feeling that sense of depression collectively and lack of optimism because of the collective position that we've been in. So that is, and the demand on the state to respond to that is really, really difficult, particularly in the financial circumstances that the UK as a whole and Scotland has faced. And in that, the Scottish Government has acted with initiative and proactively, whether it's the higher funding for the police service than elsewhere in the UK, the support that it's tried to provide the Crown Office, the Violence Reduction Unit, Community Justice Scotland, cashback initiatives, and increased spending for mental health. But there is more to be done, and in that challenge is the balancing of rights, but also the need to work with partners. And I have to say, where I have seen impact in my constituency, in particularly in North Edinburgh, it is the youth work organisations working collaboratively that have made the biggest difference. And I have to be honest and state that most of the funding for that has come from trusts and private sources. So the main message I'd want to emphasise is, yes, there's criminal justice aspects to this, but most importantly, youth work works. And the more resource that we can find for youth work initiatives in our communities, the bigger difference we can make. And lastly, I would say this, and I do think we should have more time in this chamber to debate these issues, because it's a challenge more widely about behaviour in our society. Some are to blame, but all of us are responsible. And we can all do more, including perhaps, I would argue, presiding officer in this chamber, by looking to give the best example that we can.
Thank you. And I call Alexander Stewart to be followed by Douglas Longton, up to 4 minutes, Mr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to contribute to this afternoon's debate and thank Daniel Johnson for securing it. I absolutely acknowledge the acute concerns that this motion states today, and I also agree that antisocial behaviour in youth is very much on the increase. It's not just in Mr. Johnson's Edinburgh constituency, but across my own region of Mid-Scotland and Fife, the sheer scale is deeply worrying, and these continue to be reported. And as we've already heard, this weekend bore out the fact that the horrific scenes we saw in Edinburgh, Glasgow and Dundee, where antisocial behaviour fireworks became a toxic cocktail and emergency service personnel were once again targeted during their line of duty, was absolutely appalling. And I look forward to hearing what the Minister says in her summing up. Only recently in my own region, the Alba Advertiser highlighted that police patrols were having to be increased in Tullacoutree and Alloa following a rise in youth-related antisocial behaviour. I am extremely concerned at the rise, and these individuals were as young as 12 and 15, and they were roaming the streets with weapons. These incidents of antisocial behaviour have almost prevalently within the high street and within town centres, but the most worrying was that young individuals were spotted in the early hours wearing masks and attempting to intimidate workers and people making local deliveries. Similar reports have also come from Stirling city centre. I have long been a supporter and call for the initiatives to ensure the utmost safety for retail and delivery workers, as long with our emergency service personnel. However, Deputy Presiding Officer, this phenomenon is now moving to another level, and there has been talk about the free bus travel for under 22s being questioned. This coincides with a number of contacts that I've heard from constituents suggesting that there may be some individuals who are using that facility. However, I believe that that is still a minority of youths jumping on the opportunity to travel further and create antisocial behaviour in different areas. Recently, I was delighted to learn of a man and gentleman, Craig McIntosh, who is becoming a peer mentor with views to engaging with young people. He is focusing alternative pathways for individuals who have risky behaviour in Stirling city centre. I believe this post was funded by Stirling Community Enterprise, Go for Stirling Bid and the Police Scotland themselves. The majority of this funding, which has come from Voluntary Enterprise Community Justice Fund. This is a real reality and a real opportunity to show that a peer mentoring situation can draw upon the experiences of past and pass them on to the next generation. Seeing this role is an opportunity to help young people turn their lives around. I very much wish Mr. McIntosh all the encouragement he has in going forward with a project of this nature. And it's important, Deputy Presiding Officer, that we see further projects like that happening across the community. We've heard today about the voluntary sector doing work, and we've heard today that that needs to be advanced. So in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, whilst Police Scotland remains desperately underfunded and undermanned, and that risks the force of them being undermined, and we've heard that also today, there is a legal responsibility to parents and guardians to ensure that young people in their care are not exposed to likely harm. And that likely harm comes in the form of harm to themselves, but mental and physical harm to others and antisocial behaviour. It is also the legislation which Police Scotland needs to robustly enforce to ensure that individuals who perpetrate any of these offences are tackled and given the full part of the law to ensure that they do not and they know where the land lies. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. And I now call briefly Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and first of all, thank Daniel Johnson for bringing this debate today. It seems from what we've heard, it's a problem right across Scotland. And briefly, Presiding Officer, I want to share the experience of what is happening right now in Aberdeen. This year, the incidence of antisocial behaviour at Union Square, Aberdeen's main city centre, shopping centre, and joined onto the bus station as well, have surged with some truly shocking incidents being reported. The Press and Journal told the story of a whistleblower worker who said, "What's happening is wrong. Union Square is the most hostile and dangerous place I have worked." He went on to describe that the toilets have become party rooms where kids as young as 12 lock themselves away to drink, roll joints and even have underage sex. He also told of a shopping trolley being thrown off the multi-storey car park, nearly striking a woman below. Police have been drafted in to try and train security guards, and senior officers are working closely with Union Square management to equip businesses with the right tools to handle youngsters hell-bent on wreaking havoc. But security guards and shop owners seem confused in what action they can take, and often they are concerned that if they were to manhandle a youth out of their shop, they may be charged. I will indeed, yes.
Stephen Kerr.
Douglas Lumsden is making an excellent speech, but it's very troubling. He mentioned shop workers and others not knowing how to deal with the youth that are causing this difficulty. This is doubly or triply true of teachers. They desperately need clear guidance about what they can and can't do, but they're not getting it. The government is putting this off. More talk, less action.
Douglas Lumsden.
No, and I completely agree with Stephen Kerr. Teachers, as well as shop owners, need to be assured that they won't be penalised for protecting their business or protecting themselves. And it's worrying that this type of behaviour, from what we've heard today, seems to be on the increase right across Scotland. And I would call on the devolved government to urgently carry out a piece of work to understand if this behaviour is actually on the increase and try to understand the reasons behind it. Daniel Johnson and Craig Hoy suggested free bus travel may be having an impact. And I agree with Sue Webber that the pressure on police resources are partly to blame, and the freeze on police recruitment will only make these matters worse. Whatever the cause, the devolved government need to act. This behaviour by groups of people are making places feel unsafe and threatening the viability of some businesses, driving people away from our city centres and are putting our shop workers into situations they should never have to deal with. And it's those workers I want to finish on. It was reported that the Nespresso stall in Union Square closed after workers said they faced assault and sexual harassment. We need to act. More needs to be done. I thank again Daniel Johnson for bringing this matter before us today and look forward to what action the government will do to tackle this problem. Thank you, President.
Thank you, Mr. Lumsden. I now call on Siobhan Brown to respond to the debate. Minister, up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, I'd like to thank Daniel Johnson for raising this really important issue and to everybody that's taken part in today's debate. And I also wanted to thank Daniel Johnson for all his historical work for the protection of retail workers previously. I have appreciated hearing about how all your constituencies have been affected by antisocial behaviour, and the incidents in some constituencies, especially last weekend, were deeply concerning and quite rightly raised in the Chamber earlier this week. Many are still under investigation by the police and are treating these matters with the seriousness and the severity that it does deserve. As Craig Hoy and Ben McPherson acknowledged in their contributions, I first of all want to recognise that, as you know, the vast majority of young people are not involved in antisocial behaviour, nor involved in the justice system. Yes?
Stephen Kerr.
Because that's just not true. It is the vast majority of the young people who are the biggest victims of this behaviour, because they often are living in fear themselves. At school and in other places, they should be safe. So to just say, oh, the majority behave themselves, which they do, and they're not affected, is just not the case.
Minister.
I do disagree. I would say that the majority of youth are not perpetrators of antisocial behaviour. It is, a small minority. And indeed, many people who take part in antisocial behaviour are not youths. This is unacceptable behaviour of a minority within our society. Regardless of who's involved, I'm nonetheless clear that everybody has the right to be and to feel safe in their community. And that is what is set out in our justice vision for Scotland. And I know that this view is shared across the chamber. Everyone has the right to go about their business, their work and their home life in safety without any fear. Some of the events from the past weekend put innocent people... Yes?
Douglas Lumsden.
Thank the Minister for taking an intervention. We heard from Ben McPherson about the story about youths going into a shop and throwing eggs and stuff. Can you advise what action the shopkeeper could take in that instance without any fear of him being charged?
Minister.
Thank you. Yes, well, I would say in any incident like that, they should be calling the police in the first instance. Some of the events from the past weekend put innocent people within our communities at risk and put those setting the fires and throwing the projectiles at risk too. Attacks against those whose job it is to keep our community safe are never acceptable, and I'm grateful to Police Scotland and the Scottish Fire Rescue Service and the partners for their bravery in going about their job and for their professional response to this dangerous and thoughtless behaviour. Presiding Officer, a number of members have referred to the abuse faced by staff and the theft of items from shops and businesses. Again, this is not acceptable. I would urge any affected businesses or individuals to contact the police, who continue to focus on keeping our community safe from harm and on investigating criminal activity. Yes?
Daniel Johnson.
I absolutely agree with the Minister. People working in shops should contact the police. The problem is that they very often don't get a response. And when you speak to the police, it's not because they don't want to respond, it's because, quite simply, there aren't enough response officers available to do that. So does she agree with me that we need to relook at that balance between central specialised resource and the number of officers we have in local divisions doing response and community work?
Minister, I can give you the time back.
Yes, sure. I thank the member for that intervention. And yes, I think one of the things we are reviewing, and I'll get to it later in my speech, on how we address this increase in antisocial behaviour, but yes, I do agree with you. As police are often the first line of response of such disorder, policing continues to be a priority for the Scottish Government, and we are investing $1.45 billion in policing in 2023-24, an increase of 6.3%, an additional $80 million in the resource budget. So I have heard from contributions from members today saying there have been police cuts. That is not accurate. Police Scotland is strengthening its approach to dealing with acquisitive crime, including shoplifting, firstly, through the sharing of regional best practice, but also through taking the lead role in the Scottish Parliament, Scottish Partnership Against Acquisitive Crime. This partnership draws together key organisations from across the society to provide a robust multi-agency approach to acquisitive crime and to support activity at local level, which is so important. As well as Police Scotland and the Scottish Government, partners also include Retailers Against Crime. As many members are aware, and some have acknowledged in their contribution, Police Scotland and local authorities lead on interventions to address antisocial behaviour at a local level. Partners working on the ground are always best placed to understand issues faced by local communities and how these can be best addressed. I know that great partnership working is already taking place throughout the country, and I very much encourage this. I recently visited Inverclyde Partnership Hub to learn firsthand about key agencies such as the police, local authorities, social housing associations, the Health and Social Care Partnership, Scottish Fire Rescue and British Transport Police were all working together to address antisocial behaviour within the local community. Presiding Officer, earlier this week, I was pleased to publish the report, The Reviewing of Scotland's Approach to Antisocial Behaviour. This is based...
Thank you for taking the intervention. Can I ask the Minister, does she think the freeze in police numbers or freeze on recruitment will make the issue better or worse?
Minister.
Thank you. Just for clarity, there have been 1,480 new recruits have joined Police Scotland since 2022. The review of Scotland's approach to antisocial behaviour, this is based on engagement work that the Scottish Government has done with the Scottish Community Safety Network to assess the appetite for reviewing our current approach to antisocial behaviour. The report's findings focus on moving towards a more preventative approach and recognising the importance of preventing antisocial behaviour from occurring in the first place, which will also continue to better tackle antisocial behaviour and provide better support for victims. Douglas Lumsden, I'm not sure if you're aware of this work that's ongoing, but members will be aware that I have accepted the recommendations and I'm working and setting up a working group on antisocial behaviour. Now, this will consider the effectiveness of current... Sorry, how much have I got, Mr.
I can give you another minute, Minister.
Okay. Okay, I want to address one issue that's raised time and time again regarding the bus passes. It is important to remember most of our young people travelling by bus do behave appropriately. The card is also used to access a variety of national and local public services across Scotland, such as school free meals and cashless catering. Therefore, it would not be appropriate for transport operators to remove cards from cardholders due to the impact that this could have on access to
other services. The Minister is concluding.
Furthermore, the Scottish Government have the power to withdraw or suspend a card if an eligible person knowingly allows a travel card to be used by another person. Travel scheme does not make the provision for blocking of cards in relation to allegations of antisocial behaviour or other inappropriate behaviour. Tackling allegations of antisocial behaviour are matters for the police and local authorities. However, we will continue to look at what may be possible and advisable and keep this under review. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate and I suspend this meeting of Parliament until 2:30.